The modern corporation has grown out of the industrial age. The industrial age began in 1712 when an Englishman named Thomas Newcomen invented a steam-driven pump to pump water out of the English coal mines so the English coal miners could get it more coal to mine rather than hauling buckets of water out of the mine. It was all about productivity, more coal per man hour. That was the dawn of the industrial age, and then it became more steel per man hour, more textiles per man hour, more automobiles per man hour, and today it's more chips per man hour, more gizmos per man hour. The system is basically the same, producing more sophisticated products today. Running a business is a tough proposition. There are costs to be minimized at every turn. And at some point, the corporation says, you know, let somebody else deal with that. Let's let somebody else supply the military power to the Middle East to protect the oil at its source. Let's let somebody else build the roads that we can drive these automobiles on. Let's let somebody else have those problems. And that is where externalities come from, that notion of let somebody else deal with that. I got all I can handle myself. So the pressure's on the corporation to deliver results now and to externalize any cost that this unwary or uncaring public will allow it to externalize. Drawing the metaphor of the early attempts to fly. The man going off of a very high cliff in his airplane with the wings flapping and the guy is flapping the wings and the wind is in his face and this poor fool thinks he's flying, but in fact he's in free fall and he just doesn't know it. Yet because the ground is so far away. But of course, the craft is doomed to crash. That's the way our civilization is. The very high cliff represents the virtually unlimited resources we seem to have when we began this journey. The craft isn't flying because it's not built according to the laws of aerodynamics, and it's subject to the law of gravity. Our civilization is not flying because it's not built according to the laws of aerodynamics for civilizations that would fly. And of course, the ground is still a long way away, but some people have seen that ground rushing up sooner than the rest of us have. The visionaries have seen it and have told us it's coming. There's not a single scientific peer-reviewed paper published in the last 25 years that would contradict this scenario. Every living system of Earth is in decline. Every life support system of Earth is in decline. And these together constitute the biosphere. The biosphere that supports and nurtures all of life, and not just our life, but perhaps 30 million other species that share this planet with us. The typical company of the 20th century, extractive, wasteful, abusive, linear in all of its processes, taking from the earth, making, wasting, sending its products back to the biosphere, waste to a landfill. I myself was amazed to learn just how much stuff the earth has to produce through our extraction process to produce a dollar of revenue for our company. When I learned, I was flabbergasted. We're leaving a terrible legacy of poison and diminishment of the environment for our grandchildren's grandchildren, generations not yet born. Some people have called that intergenerational tyranny, a form of taxation without representation, levied by us, some generations yet to be. It's the wrong thing to do. For 21 years, I never gave a thought to to what we were taking from the earth or doing to the earth in the making of our products. And then in the summer of 1994, we began to hear questions from our customers we'd never heard before. What's your company doing for the environment? And we didn't have answers. The real answer was not very much. And it really disturbed many of our people, not me so much as them. And a group in our research department decided to convene a task force and bring people from our businesses around the world to come together to assess our company's worldwide environmental position, to begin to frame answers for those customers. They asked me if I would come and speak to that group and give them a kickoff speech to launch this new task force with an environmental vision. And I didn't have an environmental vision. I did not want to make that speech. And at sort of the propitious moment, this book landed on my desk. It was Paul Hawkins' book, The Ecology of Commerce. And I began to read The Ecology of Commerce, really desperate for inspiration. And very quickly into that book, I found the phrase, the death of birth. It was E.O. Wilson's expression for species extinction, the death of birth. And it was a point of a spear into my chest. And I read on, and the spear went deeper, and it became an epiphanal experience, a total change of mindset for myself, and a change of paradigm. Can any product be made sustainably? Well, not any and every product. Can you make landmines sustainably? Well, I don't think so. There's a more fundamental question than that about landmines. Some products ought not be made at all. Unless we can make carpets sustainably. You know, perhaps we don't have a place in a sustainable world, but neither does anybody else making products unsustainably. One day early in this journey, it dawned on me that the way I've been running Interface is the way of the plunderer. Plundering something that's not mine, something that belongs to every creature on earth. And I said to myself, my goodness, the day must come when this is illegal, that when plundering is not allowed. I mean, it must come. So I said to myself, my goodness, someday people like me will end up in jail. I ask myself oftentimes why so many companies subscribe to corporate social responsibility. I'm not sure it's because they necessarily want to be responsible in an ultimate way, but because they want to be identified and seen to be responsible. But who am I to judge? Who am I to judge? It's better they belong than not belong. It's better that they make some public profession than the opposite. Do I know you well enough to call you fellow plunderers? There is not an industrial company on earth, not an institution of any kind, not mine, not yours, not anyone's, that is sustainable. I stand convicted by me, myself alone, not by anyone else, as a plunderer of the earth, but not by our civilization's definition. By our civilization's definition, I'm a captain of industry, in the eyes of many a kind of modern-day hero. But really, really, the first industrial revolution is flawed. It is not working. It is unsustainable. It is the mistake. And we must move on to another and better industrial revolution and get it right this time. When I think of what could be, I visualize an organization of people committed to a purpose. And the purpose is doing no harm. I see a company that has severed the umbilical cord to earth for its raw materials, taking raw materials that have already been extracted and using them over and over again, driving that process with renewable energy, It is our plan, it remains our plan, to climb Mount Sustainability. That mountain that's higher than Everest, infinitely higher than Everest, far more difficult to scale. That point at the top, symbolizing zero footprint.